Today Dr. Mansoor is going to be presenting. He's from OHSU, kind enough to present on diagnostic reasoning. RPNA recommended him, so hopefully it should be a fun lecture.
Thank you, Talar. So we can get started, and just want to thank you guys again. A special thanks to you, Talar, and RPNA for inviting me and organizing this. I really appreciate it. So as Talar mentioned, this is a talk on diagnostic reasoning, and a lot of the concepts that are in this talk are from my textbook, Frameworks for Internal Medicine. We should begin by asking the question. And actually, even before we begin, just want to let you guys know that feel free to use the chat to interact with me during the talk. I might ask questions and you can use the chat to answer. Or if you guys have questions that come up throughout the talk, just go ahead and use it. If I see it, I'll answer, but if not, we'll get to it at the end. We'll go back and look through the chat log. And also feel free to unmute yourself as well if you want to speak up, but you can use the chat if you need to. So let's ask the question, what is diagnostic reasoning? And the way I define it is the skillful acquisition and use of clues from the patient's history, exam, and other data to make a diagnosis. This is similar to how a detective will gather clues from a crime scene to solve a case. And again, it's the acquisition and use of clues with an emphasis on acquisition. You could have the same crime scene with the same information in it, and you could have 10 different detectives evaluate that crime scene, and some of them are going to glean important pieces of information from that crime scene that others glossed over or missed entirely. And the same is true in medicine. As clinicians, the onus is on us to gather the clues from the patients that we later use to make a diagnosis. And the process of making a diagnosis, it's a skill and an art form that requires understanding and lots of practice. And I think that that's really where we should be focused on in terms of medical education. I think we spend far too much time on treatment and management. I see students memorizing treatment and management and not enough time talking about the diagnostic process. Once a diagnosis has been made, that's the hard part. Making the diagnosis of acute pericarditis, for example, that's the hard part. Now you can always, from there, look up the treatment or management, whether it's an NSAID or colchicine and what the dose is. But the process of making a diagnosis is not so straightforward, and it's not something that you can simply look up. To make a diagnosis, a clinician has to, at the very least, do three things. Number one, the clinician has to know what information is important to acquire from a particular case. You don't want to be the type of clinician that asks a head-to-toe review of systems on every patient, hoping to stumble upon a clue, or perform a head-to-toe physical exam, hoping to stumble upon a finding, or order every lab test imaginable, hoping that you'll uncover some abnormality. You want to let the case, information from the case as it comes to you, dictate and guide you in terms of what information you need to acquire from the case. And it's not enough to know what information is important to acquire. You have to have the skills to acquire that information. So what do I mean by that? Well, for example, you may realize that the lung exam is important in a particular case, but that's useless unless you have the skills to properly perform a lung exam, to percuss the dullness, to auscult the rouse. And so again, it's important to know what information is important to acquire, and then you have to have the skills to acquire that information. Then finally, you take that information and you synthesize it to make a diagnosis. And all three of these steps are related. Without one, you can't do two. Without two, you can't do three. Without three, you can't make a diagnosis. Now, standardized tests play a role in medical education, but to me, they create a sort of a fantasy world where they give you all the clues that you would need kind of on a silver platter to solve a case. You know, they tell you about the patient's travel history to India last month. They tell you that there's an S3 Gallopon exam. In the real world, patients don't show up to us with signs saying, I was in Brazil last month, or I have an S3 Gallop, listen right here. The clinician has to gather that information. Number one, the clinician has to realize that travel history is important and then ask that question. The clinician, in the case of the S3 Gallop, has to, number one, know that listening to the heart is important in this case. Number two, has to be able to skillfully and properly listen to the heart. Number three, has to be able to identify or recognize that S3 Gallop. And then number four, has to understand how that S3 Gallop shapes the case. And so it's really multi-layered here. And that's why, by the way, computers will never replace clinicians. I think we can imagine a world, and it probably already exists, where there's a machine or a computer and you input information and or clues into that machine and it will come up with a diagnosis. But someone has to gather those clues that you know, go into the machine, and that is what a clinician does. And so there will always be a role for clinicians in making a diagnosis and in patient care. I'm going to illustrate how important those first two steps of the diagnostic process are, knowing what information is important to acquire and then having the skills to acquire that information, by taking us through three cases. And in each of these cases, the patient presented with dyspnea. So let's look at patient number one here. And there are three findings that are illustrated side by side here. There's a photo of the patient's mouth, a photo of the patient's hands, and a photo of the patient's chest wall. And now would be a good time to use the chat or unmute yourself if you want to. What findings are present here, and how can we unify them to make a diagnosis? Okay, looks like, yep, he does have some what looks like fillings in the past. That could definitely inform what's going on here. I think I know where you're going with that, Harris. It's, you know, could he have infective endocarditis based on the condition of his teeth? That's a great thought.
He has a scar indicating prior surgery in his sternum.
Perfect. Man, you guys are good. You're finding things that I wasn't even hoping that you would find. So that's excellent. What are some other findings here? Maybe looking at the patient's palate, looking at his fingers, and then in addition to the chest wall scar, high arch palate. Good, Caroline. Yeah, exactly. And what about the hands and the chest wall? Do his fingers look a little long and thin and spindly? Yeah, exactly. So that's called arachnodactyly. And on his chest wall, in addition to the scar, which was astutely observed by someone, he also has a chest wall deformity. And putting these all together, Sammy is absolutely right. This is somebody with Marfan syndrome. Now, when these clues are sort of presented side by side in this way, or on a standardized test, they might simply tell you the patient has a high arch palate, arachnodactyly, and a chest wall deformity. It's a lot easier to arrive at the diagnosis of Marfan syndrome. But in the real world, in reality, as clinicians, we want to be able to do more than just synthesize. Step three, we want to do steps one and two. We want to be the clinicians who recognize all of these findings on exam. When Marfan, you know, comes into our mind is on the differential diagnosis, we know as a clinician that it's important to look in the mouth. Not only that, but we have the skills to recognize or identify high arch palate. We know that it's important to look at the patient's hands. Not only that, but we can recognize arachnodactyly. And finally, we know that it's important to look at the chest wall. Not only that, but we can recognize the chest wall deformity. And then we can synthesize and bring it together in terms of the unifying diagnosis of Marfan syndrome. So nice job. And we're not done with this case, though. Remember, this patient presented with dyspnea. So what valvular condition do patients with Marfan syndrome frequently develop that can lead to dyspnea? Yep, they definitely develop mitral valve prolapse. They also develop aortic root dilation, which can lead to aortic insufficiency. Perfect. And so if you're thinking about aortic insufficiency, that's now a hypothesis. And you should anticipate what you might hear on exam when you listen to that patient. And anticipation is so key to medicine. You know, anytime you examine a patient or order an EKG or a chest x-ray or a lab, you should try to anticipate what findings might be present on that EKG or that chest x-ray. You never want to be surprised in any big way by a result that comes in. I mean, sometimes that happens, but you want to try to minimize that. You want to anticipate. And anticipating will allow you to pick up and to observe things that you otherwise may not have. So if you're thinking about aortic insufficiency, you want to listen to that, to the heart, and you want to listen for a certain thing. The old expression, the eyes can't see what the mind doesn't know, or in this case, the ears can't hear what the mind doesn't know. So when you're listening to the patient's heart, you want to anticipate, if this patient has aortic insufficiency, what am I specifically listening for? So what would you guys listen for specifically? What would you expect to hear when you listen to the heart? Yes, exactly, Arpina. You'd expect to hear a diastolic murmur. And so you're listening with that in mind, and that is exactly what you hear. You hear a decrescendo diastolic murmur over Erb's point, which is quite consistent with aortic insufficiency. So now that's becoming even more likely. So now, when you look at the patient's neck, what would you anticipate seeing in the neck that you might have otherwise glossed over? But now you have an idea in your mind, and now you're looking specifically for something in the neck regarding the carotid pulse. What would you expect to see in somebody with aortic insufficiency in the carotid pulse? Or any peripheral pulse, really.
Bounding pulse?
Yeah, you'd expect to see a bounding pulse, exactly. Pulsus parvus ad tardus would be what you might expect in somebody with aortic stenosis. But in insufficiency, you get this really big bolus of blood with every, you know, cycle, with every beat that goes up and creates this large bounding pulse. And when you look at the patient's neck, that's exactly what you see. Look at that arterial pulse. That is really impressive and definitely not normal. And it might be something that you gloss over unless, again, you're anticipating what you might see. The eyes don't see what the mind doesn't know. So you're able to put all three of these clues or all of these findings together to make the diagnosis of aortic insufficiency. But again, you don't want to be the clinician who can only synthesize information to come up with a diagnosis. You want to be the clinician who's observing, who's hearing that diastolic murmur at the bedside, who's observing Corrigan's pulse in the neck. Let's move to patient number two. And this is a video of the patient's jugular venous pulse. And what do you guys notice? And hopefully the video is playing in high resolution and as clearly as it is for me. What do you notice here about this patient's jugular venous pulse? What's the finding here? Specifically with regard to the respiratory cycle, and David is absolutely right. This is Kussmaul sign. So this is a paradoxical rise in jugular venous pressure with inspiration. And what else do you notice about this patient? What's this skin finding here? This circular blue mark right here underneath the logo. He might have several of them arranged in a field on his chest. Do you guys know what that might be? I'll give you a clue. It's an iatrogenic sort of mark on his chest. It was put there, it was placed there. That's right, radiation tattoo markers indicating that the patient has had previous radiation to the chest. So how might you put these two signs together? So he's got a Kussmaul sign and prior radiation to the chest. How could you put those two things together to make a diagnosis of this patient's dyspnea? What could unify those two things? Yeah, it could have constrictive pericarditis, exactly. Yeah, it could have pericardial involvement. Good, absolutely. And if we think back to our machine, if you input Kussmaul sign and radiation tattoo markers, it will output, like you guys did, constrictive pericarditis. It might also say, well, could he have radiation-induced interstitial lung disease with cor pulmonale leading to right heart failure and Kussmaul sign? Could he have radiation-induced valvular disease leading to right heart failure and Kussmaul sign? The point is that, you know, any robot or any machine can take clues from the patient and synthesize them to make a diagnosis, but the clinician must do more than that. The clinician has to observe Kussmaul sign at the bedside. No machine is going to be able to do that for you. And the clinician has to observe those radiation tattoo markers, and then you were able to put them together and synthesize them to make a diagnosis. And here is an up-close image of that radiation tattoo marker. They're usually blue in color, circular, and again, arranged into a field wherever they had radiation on their body. And this patient did indeed have constrictive pericarditis. So nice job, you guys. Let's move into patient number three. And not only did this patient present with dyspnea, but also in addition to that, had the clinical syndrome of heart failure. So was complaining of orthopnea, had PND, had elevated jugular venous pressure on exam. And here are his vital signs. And what do you guys notice? What stands out to you about these vital signs, if anything? Wide pulse pressure, exactly. So the difference between his systolic pressure and his diastolic pressure is quite large. And what condition do you normally associate with wide pulse pressure? Yeah, those are good answers, really good answers, and they're all right. Those are all excellent. And in my mind, I always associate it with aortic insufficiency, but all of those answers that you guys gave are 100% right. So if I'm thinking about aortic insufficiency, I'm going to specifically look at this patient's fingernails. Am I looking at every patient's fingernails that I evaluate? Probably not. But in this case, I'm interested in looking at the fingernail beds. Why? What do we see here in this video of this patient's fingernails? Yes, they are pulsating. Exactly. They're pulsatile. And that's known as Quincke's pulse. And again, wide pulse pressure and Quincke's pulse are often associated with aortic insufficiency. So we're thinking this patient's heart failure is from aortic insufficiency, or at least that's what I was thinking when I evaluated this patient. What if I told you that the echocardiogram, but even before that, you listen to the heart and there's no diastolic murmur. The echocardiogram showed a completely pristine aortic valve, totally normal, no aortic insufficiency whatsoever. Also had normal systolic function, by the way. So what are you thinking now? And some of you guys were already thinking this because the answers you gave before were right on the money. So turns out that wide pulse pressure and Quincke's pulse are simply physical findings of high output physiology. And they can be caused by things other than aortic insufficiency. And so if you have somebody presenting with heart failure with clinical signs of high output physiology, what should we be thinking at this point? What type of heart failure might this patient have? This patient might have, yeah, exactly, high output heart failure. And Luis is already supplying answers to my next question, which is, what are the causes of high output heart failure? So wet beriberi, thyrotoxicosis, liver disease, sepsis, shunts, excellent. And if you're thinking about wet beriberi, what might you go back with that in mind? Now that's in that's a hypothesis now in your mind. What would you go back and ask the patient about specifically? What's a risk factor for, at least in the Western world, what's the biggest risk factor for development of thiamine deficiency? Yeah, alcohol use. And you go back and you ask this patient specifically about alcohol use, and it turns out that he's drinking 3 to 4 glasses of wine a day. So heavy alcohol use, setting him up for thiamine deficiency. And when you check that lab, it's quite low, confirming the diagnosis of wet beriberi. And why is it so important to highlight this case? Well, I would say that most clinicians probably would not have observed the wide pulse pressure as you guys did, and may not have observed the Quincke's pulse, and probably would have given this gentleman a diagnosis of heart failure with preserved systolic function, which is a very common diagnosis that we make every single day. And that's probably the diagnosis that would have been made in this case had those observations not been made. And why is it so important to observe those findings? Well, it led us to the diagnosis of wet beriberi. And that diagnosis is so important to make because it's treatable. It's absolutely completely reversible with alcohol cessation and thiamine replacement. This patient's pulse pressure completely narrowed over time, and he was absolved. I mean, his heart failure completely reversed, and so he no longer had heart failure, did not need any diuretics or anything else. So he was completely cured. And again, it comes back to knowing what information is important to acquire and then acquiring that information from the case and then synthesizing it to make the diagnosis. So to summarize the talk to this point, to make a diagnosis, we have to do three things. We have to know what information is important to acquire. We have to have the skills to acquire that information. Then we synthesize that information to make a diagnosis. And we're going to focus the rest of the talk on step number one, which is knowing what information is important to acquire. How do we do this? Well, one strategy is to create a differential diagnosis. I always try to identify some problem in a case, whether it's a symptom or a physical finding or an abnormal laboratory test, that I can build a differential diagnosis around. And the earlier you do this, the better. Why? Because now your interaction with that patient is entirely hypothesis driven. Now you have a collection of hypotheses. That's what a differential diagnosis is a collection of hypotheses that will inform you, that it will tell you what information do I need to gather from this patient in order to rule in or rule out this hypothesis. It will tell you what questions to ask them. It will tell you what physical findings to look for, and it will tell you what labs to order. And by the way, the history and the exam are all you need to make most diagnoses. That's an important point. You don't want to be the type of clinician that orders all the labs that you can imagine on every patient you see. For example, in patient number three, you know, are we ordering thiamine levels on every patient that we evaluate? We're definitely not doing that. We did it in that case because we had a hypothesis of thiamine deficiency, and ordering that test proved our hypothesis correct in that case. If you order the sort of the shotgun approach to labs, and you order every lab you can imagine on every patient you see, you're going to do them a big disservice. It comes at a high cost to patients, both literally, because these tests cost money, and figuratively, because testing begets more testing and sometimes begets procedures. For example, and procedures have complications. For example, if you order a CAT scan on a patient unnecessarily and it shows a spot in their liver that was otherwise benign and doing no harm to the patient, now all of a sudden they undergo an invasive procedure, and let's say they start bleeding, they have a hemorrhagic complication from that procedure. Now they're in the ICU fighting for their life, all because of an unnecessary CAT scan. So part of diagnostic reasoning is being a steward and being judicious about the labs that you order. You should only order the studies that you need to order. So let's talk more about differential diagnosis. So it's important to understand that a differential diagnosis is more than just a list. It should be organized in some way. And the example that I like to use, the non-medical example, is imagine if I asked you to name all the states in the United States of America randomly as quickly as you could. You'd get going and you get a good start, and then eventually you become disorganized and start to slow down and come to a stop. If instead of doing it randomly, you had a method behind it, let's say you said, okay, I'm going to do this alphabetically and start with the states, start with letter A, then B, then C, and so on. Or you did it geographically and started in the Northwest, Southwest, Northeast, Southeast, you'd be a lot better off. And the same is true in medicine. We're asked to, you know, recall these long lists of differential diagnoses. There's 30 things that cause dyspnea, 30 things that cause chest pain, 30 things that cause anemia. There's a host of things that cause systemic vasculitis. And I would really encourage you not to kind of organize it in your mind this way in just a linear sort of list like this. Don't do this. You should organize it in some way. And here's that same list for systemic vasculitis organized by size of blood vessel involved: large vessel, medium vessel, small vessel. It is so much easier to recall this list of diagnoses when you have it organized in this way. And that's one of the great benefits of the framework system, is it really enhances your memory and recall. And this is evidence-based. They studied this back in the 1950s and 60s. In the memory and learning literature, they did these studies where they had one group of individuals they gave them a list of words that were listed randomly and said, memorize these words. They gave the same list of words to a second group, but this time those words were tethered together in some way into a framework. And here's an example of that. Here's a list of minerals organized into a framework. And they told that group, memorize, this list of words. And when they tested them, they discovered that the group that had the benefit of an organized list of words, the benefit of a framework, were much more easily able to recall that list than the control group. The other benefit to the framework system is it can suggest a diagnostic workup depending on the framework. So here's the same framework for systemic vasculitis. If we look at the small vessel arm, it subdivides into a serologic test, ANCA positive, ANCA negative. So if I'm approaching a patient that I think might have small vessel vasculitis and I'm armed with this framework, then it automatically tells me what serologic study I might think about ordering in this case, because small vessel vasculitis is on my differential. The same is true for the framework for pleural effusion, which subdivides into transitate versus exudate, which of course is based on Light's criteria. So again, if I have this framework in mind and I'm approaching a patient with pleural effusion, it automatically tells me this patient, you know, to understand that the nature of this fluid, I would need to perform a thoracentesis, send that fluid for LDH and protein so I could calculate Light's criteria and figure out, is it a transudate or exudate? Same is true for the framework for hyponatremia, where the hypotonic arm subdivides by volume status into hypovolemic, euvolemic, hypervolemic. So again, if I have this framework in mind and I'm approaching a patient with hyponatremia, I'm specifically looking on exam, I'm paying very close attention to their volume status because it's critical to the differential diagnosis. So those are the two big benefits of the framework system. And why don't we use what we've learned and apply it to a case? And this is a case from the book. And you'll see that you'll notice that I've concealed some of the information from this case from you because I don't want to simply give you the clues that you would need to synthesize to make the diagnosis. We want to practice step one, which is knowing what information is important to acquire from a case first. And then we'll acquire that information and try to solve it. And we'll do that by, we'll come up with a framework for a problem in this case. And that framework will serve as our collection of hypotheses. And that will inform us, it will tell us what information we need to know from the case to rule in or rule out a given hypothesis that's in our framework. So let's begin here. So this is a case of a 51-year-old man with positional dyspnea, a 51-year-old man with a history of chronic hepatitis C infection complicated by cirrhosis presents to the emergency department with shortness of breath. He has been followed by a hepatologist for management of hepatic encephalopathy, ascites, and esophageal varices, which have been stable for several years. The patient has a history of shortness of breath that typically resolves following large volume paracentesis, which he has occasionally required. However, over the past few months, the patient has noticed progressive dyspnea despite control of the ascites. Heart rate is 100 beats per minute. Respiratory rate is 24 breaths per minute. Hemoglobin oxygen saturation by pulse oximetry, or SpO2, is 85% on room air with the patient in the upright position. Arterial blood gas on room air shows that the pH is 7.48. The partial pressure of carbon dioxide, or PaCO2, is 32 millimeters of mercury, and the partial pressure of oxygen is 56 millimeters of mercury. What is the most likely cause of hypoxemia in this patient? So now we want to pick a framework. We want to choose a problem and build our framework around it. And you could probably pick, there's two obvious choices in this case, dyspnea and hypoxemia. Either one would be good choices. And sometimes in a case where there's multiple disparate problems going on, it's helpful to build a framework for each of those separate problems and then focus on where there's overlap. And that's similar to how a Venn diagram works. For the sake of this talk, we're going to choose hypoxemia as our framework. Before we build the framework, just a little bit of the basics on hypoxemia. So it describes a physiologic state in which the partial pressure of oxygen is low, with normal being between 80 and 100 millimeters of mercury on room air. And we all remember this oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, where on the x-axis, you have the partial pressure of oxygen of arterial blood. And on the y-axis, you have the percent saturation of hemoglobin. And obviously, as the partial pressure of oxygen goes up in blood, so does the saturation of hemoglobin. But it doesn't do so in a linear fashion. There's an S shape to this curve. And the numbers that I like to commit to memory from this curve are 27 and 60. Why 27? Because that corresponds to 50% hemoglobin saturation. And why 60? Because that corresponds to 90% hemoglobin saturation. So I just find that those are two nice points of reference when I'm thinking about partial pressure of oxygen and percent saturation of hemoglobin. So now let's build our framework for hypoxemia. And the first branch point is whether the patient has a normal AA gradient or an elevated AA gradient. And so that begs the question, what is an AA gradient? An AA gradient is the difference in partial pressure of oxygen between the alveoli or the lungs, that's the big A, and arterial blood, which is the little a. So here we, and this is how our body works, we breathe in oxygen into our alveolar space, and there's a partial pressure of oxygen inside the lungs, and it diffuses across into the arterial, into the capillary, and into the arterial system. So the AA gradient is simply measuring the difference between oxygen in the alveolar space and oxygen in the arteries. How do we obtain big AO2? How do we know how much oxygen is in the lung? How do we obtain little AO2? Big AO2 is obtained using the alveolar gas equation, while little AO2 is simply measured with an arterial blood gas test or an ABG. So let's focus on calculating the big AO2. And to do that, we need to know, we need to look at the alveolar gas equation. I know sometimes in medicine, it's very intimidating or challenging to look at these equations, but this is one that I would really encourage you guys to commit to memory and to break down and understand. It's similar, it can really help you. It's similar to cardiac output equals heart rate times stroke volume. That's a really helpful equation to understanding physiology and hemodynamics in the heart. And the same is true for the alveolar gas equation. It can really help you understand hypoxemia. So when we break it down, really, we can kind of separate it out into two terms. So big AO2 is equal to the difference between these two terms. So what's the first term? This is the fraction of inspired oxygen multiplied by barometric or atmospheric pressure. So that tells you how much, essentially the oxygen content that you're inspiring. And then you're subtracting from that PaCO2, or the amount of carbon dioxide in your blood, which is a function of ventilation. So this is really how much oxygen you're taking in. And then you're subtracting from that a term that gets at how well you're ventilating, you know, and allowing oxygen to come into the lungs. So what is the fraction of inspired oxygen of room air? You guys know? 21%, perfect. How about barometric or atmospheric pressure at sea level? 760 millimeters of mercury, perfect. Water vapor pressure is 47. What is a normal partial pressure of carbon dioxide in arterial blood? And the respiratory quotient, don't worry about that so much. It depends somewhat on diet, but it's usually around 0.8. So now that we know the terms of the alveolar gas equation, let's calculate what my lungs are seeing here in Portland, Oregon, or what you guys are seeing in Pasadena. It's pretty similar. You guys are a little bit higher elevation than we are here in Portland, but we're pretty much right at sea level in Portland. So let's plug in these numbers. So we'll use 21%, 760, 47, 40, and 0.8. And it turns out that my lungs are seeing a partial pressure of oxygen of around 100 millimeters of mercury. And hopefully my lungs are working really well. And let's just assume that there is no AA gradient. So the oxygen is diffusing perfectly well across the capillary membrane and into the arterial blood. Well, that's why I'm satting my partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood should be right around 100. And that's why I saturate 99 to 100%. Let's calculate the same value, the big AO2, for someone in Mexico City. I gave this talk to a group in Mexico City, and I realized that they're at quite a high elevation. They're at something like a little over 7,000 feet above sea level. So the atmospheric pressure there is not 760, it's now 580 millimeters of mercury. And because of compensatory hyperventilation, their normal PaCO2 in Mexico City is not 40, it's 30. And so when you do the calculation, it turns out that their big AO2 is right around 75. And so someone in Mexico City who has normal lungs is saturating in the mid to low 90s. And it turns out that we're allowed a little bit of an AA gradient depending on age. So at age 20, we're allowed an AA gradient of up to about 17. And at age 80, we're allowed a gradient of up to about 38. So let's get back to the framework and let's focus on patients who have a normal AA gradient. And it still right now might seem paradoxical to you guys. How could somebody be hypoxemic with a normal AA gradient? So why don't we illustrate how that might be the case? And let's talk, so really the little a, you have to understand the little a is really at the mercy of the big A. So if something compromises how much oxygen is in the lungs, even if you have normal diffusion across, well, the little A can only be good as good as the big A. So if the big A is down, then so will the little A. And it gets back to the alveolar gas equation in terms of what can compromise big AO2. And it comes back to these two terms that we already talked about. So if something's compromising the partial pressure of inspired oxygen, or something's compromising your ability to ventilate and your PaCO2 goes up, if either of these two things happen, well, your lungs aren't gonna see a high partial pressure of oxygen. So big AO2 goes down. And even if you have normal diffusion, little AO2 will also be down as a result of that. So it's these two things, those two terms in the alveolar gas equation, reduced partial pressure of inspired oxygen and hypoventilation will lead to hypoxemia in the setting of a normal AA gradient. And just to really illustrate this, let's go through an example of somebody who's hypoventilating. So let's calculate the big AO2 in somebody with a PaCO2 of 80. So remember, normal is 40. So they're hypoventilating and they have a PaCO2 of 80. Well, if you plug in all the numbers, but instead of 40, you use 80, it turns out that their big AO2 is only around 50 millimeters of mercury. And even if they have pristine lungs, again, they're hypoxemic. You know, 50 millimeters of mercury is not a normal partial pressure of oxygen in arterial blood, and that's going to correspond to a saturation in the mid-80s. So hopefully that makes sense how somebody could have hypoxemia in the setting of a normal AA gradient. And so I'll ask you guys to kind of help fill in this differential. What are the causes of reduced partial pressure of inspired oxygen, and what are the causes of hypoventilation? Perfect, high elevation, exactly, will compromise your amount of inspired oxygen. Guillain-Barré for hypoventilation or some other neuromuscular disorder, perfect. Yeah, CNS depression from things like benzos or narcotics, we see that all the time in the hospital. So that's a pretty good list. So let's change gears and now focus on this arm of the framework in which there is an elevated AA gradient. So here, the difference, again, between the alveolar, the partial pressure of oxygen in this space is now much different than the partial pressure of oxygen in this space. So why would that happen? It turns out there's four basic mechanisms for why you might have a difference in the partial pressure of oxygen between those two spaces. You could have, in the first example, VQ mismatch in the form of dead space. So here your V is good, your lungs are aerating really well, but your blood flow is compromised. So your V is good, but your Q is not good. So that's VQ mismatch in the form of dead space. You could also have VQ mismatch in the form of physiologic shunt. So here your Q is quite good, but your V is compromised. Your aeration is compromised by something filling the alveoli, or maybe they're collapsed and they're not aerating properly. So you have VQ mismatch in the form of physiologic shunt. Here in the third example, you have good aeration, you have good blood flow. Those aren't the problem, but here you have thickening of the capillary membrane. Maybe there's a little fibrosis there that's impairing the diffusion of oxygen across. And then in the last example, here you have normal V, your Q is fine. There's no thickening of the capillary membrane, but here you have a shunt that's simply bypassing the alveoli altogether and taking deoxygenated blood over to the arterial side, the pulmonary venous side. So what are some causes? Let's just name maybe one or two in each category. What's the classic cause of dead space where you have normal aeration in the lung, but you have no blood flow to that area of the lung? Pulmonary embolism, perfect. How about physiologic shunt? What could fill the alveoli that would compromise aeration? Pneumonia, so that might be pus, exactly. Could it be water in the form of pulmonary edema? Could it be hemorrhage? Exactly, in the form of diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, perfect. How about diffusion impairment? What could cause a little fibrosis there, thickening? Exactly, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, interstitial lung disease. And then where are the two locations in the body in which you can get significant right to left shunting? What two organs could be involved? You can get cardiac shunts. And what's the other big one? Yeah, pulmonary, perfect, exactly. So let's fill in that differential that you guys came up with. And again, it really illustrates how nice it is to have a framework when you're thinking through a problem, because having that skeleton, that outline, will allow you to fill in the diagnoses. Think, oh, I know what causes dead space. I know what causes impaired diffusion. And it really allows you to recall the full differential diagnosis. So let's go back to our case now that we have the full framework for approaching hypoxemia. And we want to know, what is the AA gradient in this case? So what is the big A? Well, we know that the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is 32 millimeters of mercury. So we can then use that to calculate big A. So we're going to assume that he's breathing room air and that he is at somewhere near sea level. And when we make that calculation, turns out that his big AO2 is somewhere around 110 millimeters of mercury. What's the little AO2 in this case? Well, again, it's just simply a measurement. It's not a calculation. We measure arterial blood gas, and we get a value of 56 millimeters of mercury. So what is the AA gradient? It's simply 110 minus 56 is 54 millimeters of mercury. And that's abnormal in any case, regardless of age. He is in his 50s, so he's allowed up to a 27 AA gradient. So this is twice that, so definitely abnormal. So that tells us that we're dealing with this arm of the framework, and this is our differential diagnosis. And anytime you can sort of narrow your differential based on a framework, you're on the right path. So now we have a collection of hypotheses here, and this informs us what information we need to extract from this case to rule in or rule out these hypotheses. And so I'm gonna ask you guys, go with the first thing there. The first item is pulmonary embolism. So if you're considering PE in a case, what historical questions would you specifically ask that patient? What physical findings would you specifically look for in that patient?
Cough, the history of surgery, hemorrhagization, neck swelling.
Perfect. Yeah, exactly. You're thinking about what might cause a DVT. Is there surgery, stasis, immobilization, hypercoagulability, recent travel? That's all perfect. And on exam, you might specifically be listening for a loud P2. You'd expect to hear clear lungs in the setting of PE. You'd look specifically for an elevated JVP. That's perfect. How about pneumonia? What historical questions and what physical findings would you specifically look for to test that hypothesis?
Cough.
Yep. Specifically a purulent cough. You'd look for focal findings on lung exam. So focal area of dullness to percussion, tubular breath sounds, rows or crackles. How about interstitial lung disease? What might you ask the patient about there or look for specifically? Sam. Yeah, exposures, exactly. Workplace exposures, cigarette exposure, thinking about hypersensitivity, pneumonitis, animals, certain animals. Yeah, exactly. Perfect. And then on exam, are there a particular type of rows or crackles that you might expect to hear in somebody with interstitial lung disease?
Fine rails.
Yeah, they're fine, or Velcro like rows or crackles. Perfect. And then what tests might you order? Let's not forget about testing. So again, we're not going to order every test imaginable on every patient, but in somebody who we're considering interstitial lung disease. I'm sorry? I think I heard, yeah, high-res CT, perfect, exactly. Or you might order pulmonary function tests, absolutely. And then in the last category, if you're thinking about anatomic shunt or right-to-left shunt, what physical finding might you specifically look for in somebody with a right-to-left shunt? You might look at their hands in particular. Maybe the ends of their fingers might look a certain way. Clubbing, perfect, or cyanosis, those are both excellent examples. And then what test would you order? How could you prove the existence of a right to left shunt? Yeah, you can get an echo. And is it any echo, or do you have to, yeah, echo with bubble? Exactly. And that's where that you take agitated saline and you inject it into the right heart. So now when you're doing the echo, you're going to see those bubbles. They're going to be hyperechoic structures in the echo, and you're going to see those bubbles on the right side of the heart. And normally the right side of the heart pumps the blood to the lungs, and normally those bubbles will dissipate in the lung. And so you should never get those bubbles returning to the left side of the heart. And if you do, you know you are dealing with a right to left shunt somewhere. If it happens very early on, within a few beats, it's an intracardiac shunt. If it happens later on, if it takes multiple beats or cardiac cycles to get to the left side of the heart, you know that shunt is a little bit further away and it's in the lung. Exactly, you guys are right on the money. What diagnosis in this collection of hypotheses would you specifically be interested in somebody with cirrhosis? Is there one in particular that you think, oh, we should hone in on that one in particular? Hepatopulmonary syndrome, exactly. And what is hepatopulmonary syndrome? Well, this is a situation where the patients with cirrhosis develop dilated pulmonary capillaries at the base of their lungs. And sometimes they actually develop, and that would give rise to physiologic shunt, but it actually is also in the anatomic shunt category as well. It's a form of intrapulmonary shunt when they form AVMs. They can form AVMs as well. So it can actually belong in both categories. And so what historical question would you specifically ask somebody if you're entertaining the question of hepatopulmonary syndrome? Is there a particular type of dyspnea that they might experience? Yeah, it's improved when laying down or and worse with sitting up. And that's known as platypnea. Perfect, exactly. Yeah, and I like how somebody also mentioned hepatic hydrothorax. Exactly. If you're evaluating somebody with dyspnea and they have cirrhosis, that should automatically make you generate a small differential diagnosis of problems that patients with cirrhosis develop that can lead to dyspnea. And one of them is hepatic hydrothorax. They can also develop portopulmonary hypertension. They can also develop ascites, which compresses the diaphragm, and that's on the differential. And they can also develop hepatopulmonary syndrome. So that's really, I'm glad that you guys mentioned all that. But yes, you would specifically ask about platypnea. Are you going to ask every patient you ever evaluate in clinic or in the hospital about platypnea specifically? No, but here you have a hypothesis. So that directs you, that tells you what information you need to gather from the case. And in this case, you're interested in platypnea. How about on exam? What's the equivalent of platypnea? Oh, I see it there already at orthodeoxia. That's the physical finding where their pulse, their saturation actually is worse in the upright position and then improves on lying flat or in the supine position. That's great. And then how about on exam? Is there anything in particular that you'd look for on exam? And we've already mentioned this. In addition to cyanosis, you might specifically look for clubbing. And then to test whether they might have hepatopulmonary syndrome, you would order a echocardiogram with bubble study. So you guys have just gone through the practice of identifying, understanding what information you need to know from the case. This isn't a standardized test. We didn't simply give you all the information that you would need, all the clues that you would need. We went through an exercise where we identified the information that we would need from the case. And we did that by creating a framework. And that framework told us what information we need to gather from the case. So now let's go back to the case and let's begin to fill in the missing information. So in the first paragraph, we learn that the breathing seems to improve when he lies on his back, and that is platypnea. And that's something that you guys specifically identified as something that you would want to know. In the second paragraph, we learn that the oxygen saturation improves from 85% in the upright position to 96% in the supine position. That is orthodeoxia. We also learn that there's spider angiomas on the anterior chest. Not surprising, he has cirrhosis. We learn that the jugular venous pressure is 7, and that helps us move, you know, pulmonary edema. That was one of the potential causes of physiologic shunt. That moves now further down differential. We don't think this is heart failure with a normal jugular venous pressure. The lungs are clear. That makes things like pneumonia less likely. It makes things like hepatic hydrothorax less likely. It makes things like heart failure less likely. And then finally, an image of the patient's hand is shown in figure 46.1 along with some additional information. And so what finding is present in that image in 46.1? Black and white, so it's harder to appreciate cyanosis, but he does have clubbing. Absolutely. And that, again, the eyes don't see what the mind doesn't know. If you didn't approach this patient thinking that he could have hepatopulmonary syndrome or some other shunt, you may not have looked closely at his hands to recognize the clubbing. That's why it's so important. I would say out of, if you had 10 clinicians evaluate this patient, how many would pick up the clubbing? I don't know, but it's not 10, it's not 100%. You want to be that clinician who recognizes the clubbing because you knew to look for it. And then finally, we're given an echocardiogram, which is just what you guys asked for. It's an echocardiogram with agitated saline, and it shows the presence of microbubbles in the right-sided cardiac chambers over here. And here's the image captured 8 cardiac cycles later, showing those bubbles on the left side of the heart. So that indicates, again, it's not within 1 or 2 cardiac cycles. So that indicates an intrapulmonary shunt. And so what is the diagnosis here? I'm gonna make you guys say it. Hepatopulmonary syndrome, perfect, exactly. And that we were able to do that because we created this framework and we were able to, that informed us what information we needed to gather from the case. We had the skills to gather that information and then we synthesized it to come up with a diagnosis. So in summary, diagnostic reasoning is the acquisition and use of clues to make a diagnosis with an emphasis on acquisition. I cannot overemphasize that. Again, standardized tests give you these clues. And it's great. You have to be able to synthesize information, but any robot, any machine can do that. You want to be the clinician who can do all 3 steps. And to help you in that process, it's nice to create a framework early on, which will then allow you to perform a hypothesis-driven workup. Thank you so much for having me. Here are the references. And for more on diagnostic reasoning, there's a textbook, of course, and it has 50 chapters, and each chapter starts off with a case. Much like what you saw here. And it kind of uses a question and answer format to kind of work through the chapter and it builds the framework. So at the end of the chapter, you're left with a full framework and hopefully you've learned some important pearls along the way. We also do stuff on social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. There are a couple of great med students who run some of those sites and they do a great job of illustrating and working through cases and really emphasize diagnostic reasoning. There's several podcasts that I would recommend. Curbsiders, Core IM, Clinical Problem Solvers. Gurpreet Dhaliwal is a master diagnostician at UCSF. And if you ever have the chance to see him, sometimes he'll do the stump the professor style lecture where he'll work through a case and he really does a masterful job. And I would really encourage you guys to see him if you can. Human DX is a good application to use. We're coming out with a website called Physical Diagnosis PDX, where the goal is to illustrate every physical finding that you've heard of or can imagine on this site. And the idea there is to allow clinicians then to be able to recognize, again, that's step 2. It's good to know that the lung exam is important in a case, or it's good to know to look for high arch palate, but that's useless unless you have the skills to recognize high arch palate. So our goal is to illustrate all these findings, heart murmurs, transient sounds, jugular venous pulse findings, skin findings, arachnodactyly, all that stuff on the site so that clinicians are equipped with what they need to recognize that at the bedside. And with that, I'll conclude. I'm happy to answer questions that you guys might have. Thanks for being such a great audience and answering all the questions throughout the talk. Now it's my turn to answer some questions if you have them.
Thank you, Dr. Mansour.
You're very welcome.